That's us live. Thank you very much. Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session being held in a roundtable format for our college regionalisation inquiry. During today's session, we will take evidence from student representatives and student association staff. So I would like to welcome Alex Bryson, who's student class representative from Fife College, Nicole Cochran, Student Association Development Officer from West Lothian College Student Association, Heather Innes, current Vice President, Higher Education and President-elect of Highlands and Islands Student Association, Kirsten Coss, Deputy President, Aberdeen Altons, is that right, Altons? North East Scotland College of Students Association, John O'Hara, who's joining us online, Senior Learner Engagement Manager, New College Lanarkshire Students Association, Amy Monks, who's also joining us online, President, Dundee and Angus College Students Association, and last but not least, Al Wilson, Director for Edinburgh College Students Association. So good morning to you all. Thank you for coming. Our session is hybrid today, and as I've mentioned, two of our witnesses, and one panel member are participating virtually. As those attending remotely won't be able to catch my eye, when you want to come in, and we may direct questions to you as well, can I ask that you put a capital R in the chat bar? That's mostly for my eyes, because I can't read lowercase. The clerks will also be monitoring the chat box, and I will bring you in when I can. Okay, so let's get going. So I think part of the regionalisation inquiry, the review, was to make sure that colleges and learning environments were much more learner-centred. So I'm opening that up to figure out, is that what your experience of the regionalisation has been? So does anyone want to go first on that one? Okay, Nicole, you're looking...
I'm happy to answer, yeah. Absolutely, I believe that that is the case. Our college, West Lothian College, has attributed lots of values to ensure that the approach to learning is definitely student-centred, including our own values, which are shared with the Student Association, which are students in the centre. They've come up with lots of different projects and initiatives to ensure that students are being listened to. They have completed and organised a project called the Trust Project, which is developed for students that have trauma backgrounds and that are looking to develop into mainstream. And they have supported those students right through the project. They like to listen to student feedback. They ensure that there's placements for students so that they're ready and eligible to progress into employment. And as I said, they listen to student feedback, and that's, I think, really, really important.
Thank you. Is anyone else wanting to make comment on that? Okay, Al, thanks.
Very similarly to Nicole, Edinburgh College has had a range of initiatives put in place to help ensure that the student voice is part of that ongoing process of review and reform as the college progresses. There are lots of mechanisms in place to ensure the student voice is heard. I think some of those areas for Edinburgh College would be support around care experience students, which is an area which has grown quite significantly at Edinburgh College over the most recent couple of years. But equally, I think it is because of the scale of Edinburgh College, which is a very large college in comparison to some, is working out the best practice at a more local level as well. So I think faculties and courses have done a good job to ensure that they're actually shaping that feedback mechanism to suit their students.
Thanks very much, Al. Amy online is wanting to contribute. Thanks, Amy.
Thank you. So at Dundee and Angus College, not only within the Students' Association, but as the college as a whole, we've been utilising service design methodology and everything we do to make sure our students are at the heart and the centre of all our planning, whether that's in the classroom, strategic planning, that they are involved and having that shared ownership of, you know, all the decisions that are getting made, implementing them and then reviewing them as well. So we feel that that's going across the board, as I said, whether that's class, CQL level, exec level, even up to board of management as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to sort of approach Stephanie Callaghan to see if you want to put some questions to the group. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Convener. Maybe coming first of all to Amy there, who's just spoken. I'm really interested. We heard in previous evidence about the idea that students really need that support to make sure that they're getting involved in the key decision making, and that when they come to boards or with the CSA, that they're not just kind of reporting back on what it is that they've done. So I'm really interested in any examples of how students have influenced some of the key decisions that have been made there. Thanks.
In 2020, we held a BombCom session, so it was still in the midst of the pandemic, so it was online, and it was all our board of management members along with all our lead reps. So they come together in a services and workshop style to inform our strategic plan for 2025, and we looked at the theme being the college of our future. So all the students and all the SA team, the senior exec, were all part of that, and they worked together. They were split into small groups and breakout rooms, utilising all the fun things we'd learned having to go digital and on the online platform Miro. And they worked together in small groups to break down assumptions, to get to know each other on a more one-to-one human level, which I think helps immensely in everything. So it wasn't a case of, oh my goodness, I'm speaking to the chair of the board. It was, no, I'm speaking to Angela. She's, you know, into this. She has shared interests as me. So it really brought down those barriers for our students to feel like they really, truly had that voice. It ran over two sessions where, you know, used all these different tools and methods to see what was that shared vision for our College of the Future. And at the end of it, we came up with six main points together, and Simon, our principal, used them to directly influence his strategic plan for the whole college for 2025, which we then shared back, obviously, to our students to say, you know, you might have to give up a couple of afternoons for us, but here's where you were involved. You know, you had your say from the very first minute of that. You were involved through that whole process, and here's how it's come out at the end, having used that. And they could directly see that feedback loop had effectively been closed, although, you know, it's always moving. They were able to see it sort of on that full scale.
That's great. And I'm just wondering if anyone else has anything to add, Convener?
Yeah, I was just wondering if Kirsten, Heather and Alex, if that was a similar experience that you're having at your institutions, colleges? Alex?
Yeah, pretty much similar experience. Myself as student rep, I've been involved in quite a lot of the conversations with regards to groups, teams, help available for other students.
Heather?
I think with UHI it varies. On an executive level, regional level, we're definitely very involved and our voice is seen as very important. When it gets down to the individual boards of management, I think it depends on... it depends on differing attitudes. We have some who, everyone says that the voice of HISA is very important, but how they come across with that differs. Some see us as really important, some make it a little bit more difficult to get things across, putting board of management meetings at times when the student officer cannot make it and has said they cannot make it ever. It does differ, but we do deal with 12 different principals rather than one, for example. So it is a complicated and unique system.
Okay, thank you. What about yourself, Kirsten?
At NESCOL we are supported to be members of the board and to have our voice heard and to influence key decisions. We have had the opportunity to meet with the chair of the... I mean, before we sat on the board, opportunity to meet with the chair, opportunity to meet with the relevant committee chairs that we'd be with, and I think that really helped to break down any potential barriers that might be there, because it can be quite intimidating when you've maybe only been at college for 1 year and then you're going to go to the board. It can be really, really intimidating, but to meet with them and to speak about, you know, silly things at the same time as discussing, you know, the priorities for the college. I think that really helps to break down those barriers.
Thank you very much. Anything else, Stephanie?
Yep, just to follow up, and perhaps this is a question for Al just now, about how important the officers' roles are in actually supporting students to make sure that they are right and they impart those key decisions.
Thanks very much. Yeah, absolutely. I think full-time officers at college, student associations are incredible, and the impact that they have is incredible. Certainly that's been my experience over the last 6 or 7 years at Edinburgh College. The officers themselves, again, it's important to put it in context of what their life cycle is as students, compared to perhaps university student association officers. College student association officers might only have been a student for a number of months before they become a full-time officer. And the support that they require, the training and the ongoing kind of personal development is a really key aspect to make sure that they their contribution is as effective as possible. From my point of view, as a full-time member of staff in a student association, a key part of that is the training and development of those officers and ongoing support throughout their term, to make sure that they are as effective as possible whenever they do get to Board of Management meetings or other committee meetings or even evidence sessions such as this, that they can actually contribute in a way that is meaningful. I think that the college student association sector is quite impressive, if I do say so myself, in that way.
Thanks. I was just wondering if John O'Hara, who's online, had anything he wanted to respond to that.
Yeah.
Over to you then, John. You're live. I think things are on.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, good. Yeah, just adding to what Al said, I mean, it's inevitable that it's so important that our student officers are supported, especially sabbaticals. And it's at New College Lanarkshire, we have three main sabbaticals. So we have, and that is down to previous experience and looking at actually what our culture of students need across the sector. And our regional, I think it's regional based, so our region is quite far apart. So our culture of students at Cumbernauld, say, in their campus compared to Motherwell, is a different demographic. So they need sometimes different support than they do maybe at Motherwell. So having these three sabbatical officers and making sure that us as staff members support their students on their campuses and they're able to be able to support the students at different levels, because students come in the door with different levels of needs, whether we like it or not. Every student demographic is different, but I definitely think the more support that we give students going through. I think 10 years ago when I was a student president to now, the difference between what student officers are required to do than they were then is hugely different, and recognising that and the college as a whole recognising that they need that support going forward is huge. So I definitely think there's change in the support that students need, especially officers, but having been lucky, having three sabbatical officers full time is definitely a plus.
Thanks. Stephanie, have you?
Just a small thing, just about Amy saying about that variation at a local level as well. I'm just wondering if she wants to put across anything that we could maybe look at putting in place or rolling out to make sure that it's happening across the board.
Amy?
Yeah, so at Dundee and Angus, I'm the only full-time sabbatical officer, and I cover our three campuses, which range from Dundee, Kingsway and Gardine, and also Arbroath. So again, you've got very much a city-based campus and then a more rural-based campus with outlying sort of towns. And we have three vice presidents that are all still current students but work 10 hours a week. We are also very lucky that we do have a staff member as well. But again, just as John said there, the needs of our different campuses are completely, completely different. And I do think that, you know, potentially having more of a presence at each campus on a full-time basis would really, really help us.
Apologies, convener. I said Amy. I actually meant Heather, and I was looking at Heather there. It was Heather that
Oh, luckily
comment.
Amy had an answer.
So sorry.
Heather, are you wanting to come in on Stephanie Callaghan's question?
Could you repeat it again? Sorry.
Sorry, it was just the fact that you'd said about that variation locally. Some areas it was working really well, some areas not so well. And I was just wondering if you had any comments on, or, you know, going forward, what might be helpful to ensure that all students right across the board are getting that impact and encouragement they need.
This is actually something that there's been work done on it this year. One of our staff members has been leading on a board of management project. So going to our local officers who sit on these boards of management, finding out what support they need and how it can be improved. And that report should be coming out very soon. So we should see some very positive changes for next year. So we're feeling very hopeful and excited about that.
Great. Thanks, convener.
And I think Nicole would like to come in on that point as well.
Yes. So. We introduced a two-year term sabbatical for our officers, and that's been really, really helpful. That's been able to build confidence, empower them to be able to contribute effectively and to support them in their journey during the two-year term.
Thanks, Nicole. Excuse me for that. Now we'll move to some questions from Ruth.
Thank you, convener. It was good to hear about the sort of positive work working between the students and the colleges, and that kind of getting to know the board and being able to go to them. I was interested particularly in what Amy said initially about the work that they did to get a shared vision. And I just wonder, to sort of flip that slightly, did that work help at a time? Because obviously you're not always going to share student voice is not always going to share the vision of the board. There may be times of conflict or where they want to change or do something the students don't agree with. Did that work on the sort of positive side of things help deal with that conflict? Has there been time where you've had to go and disagree with direction or with a specific thing that the management are wanting to do?
I think because we have that sort of shared ownership's maybe not the right word, but that shared view and involvement. I think when it comes to making more difficult decisions or having to change things, because they've built up that really good mutual respect, that culture, when things do need to take a turn, they still involve the students at that point, or they come back to us and say, you know, we've tried this, it's not going to happen, or it's not working. Can we go back to the students and, you know, develop something new? So that there is that really open channel of communication for us, where we feel comfortable to do that with the students' voice at heart still.
Okay, so do you feel you can challenge decisions that you don't agree with?
Yes.
Okay. I'd be interested to hear from the other students on that, convener.
Yes, I know Kirsten wants to come in to respond to Mr. Cush's right there in terms of the last question, so there's that as well, and perhaps you can repeat the question as well to see if Kirsten might be able to respond to yours.
I'll come in on what you okay. want to see first, though, don't want any confusion.
Just in response to the previous question, I think Amy had mentioned something about how different the campuses are at Dundee and Angus, and I think that's something that we really struggle with in terms of kind of having students involved. So we have, at NESCOL, we have three different, very different campuses and a couple of different learning centres. We have a very rural, or a campus that serves a rural area, a city-based campus, and a campus that serves for like construction and those kind of professions. And the students that attend those campuses are very, very different, and they're served by one regional president, and the two smaller campuses are served by part-time presidents. It's really hard to build a culture where students feel like they're at the heart of decision making when you're only there 17 hours a week, and especially for myself, I represent two campuses, to split my time over that at 17 and a half hours per week, it's really difficult to say, you know, you are involved when you don't have the time to do that. And students do know that they can come forward, but you can't build a culture in such a short amount of time. So I completely agree with the full-time structure. And I think that's a side effect of regionalisation. We have a group of very different people spread across a large area. You know, I think it's a lot easier for smaller kind of colleges, maybe like City of Glasgow, where they cover a really small area, whereas we cover such a huge area that our students are so different. We need more time to engage with students.
Thank you. Ruth, if you've got any further...
Thank you. I think my colleague Graham Day would probably want to explore some of that with you later, so if I'll just go back to my question, if that's okay, which was, and I suppose in some ways you've answered it about the challenges of being represented, but it's just whether, along with all the good work that's done by the college themselves to help bring representatives on and feel able to challenge, if there were times that you could challenge decisions and that you felt that the work that was done helped you do that.
I think sometimes it can be really hard to challenge decisions from a students' association point of view, because we're funded by the college, we're a department of the college, so it can be really difficult to disagree. And also, when you disagree with the college, it can break down those relationships you've built with senior staff. And when you know that they're funding your students' association and they're funding the work you do, it's really, really difficult to completely disagree. I recently visited Forth Valley College, and they have an arm's length funding model. And then, of course, there's Edinburgh College, who are kind of completely independent, the Students' Association. And I think that there has to be some degree of independence, because it's really difficult to be part of the college and say, we don't agree with you, knowing that your funding and your relationships with staff depends on that.
I need to come in on that point, Ruth.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's great. Thanks, Convener. I think that it's important to note that the college student associations are established in very different ways across the country, and Edinburgh College is unique in that it has a student association which is a separate charity and has staff that runs the student association in an autonomous way. We are still funded by the college, but in a slightly more separated way, which gives us an opportunity to be more autonomous and actually challenge some of those decisions and have our own strategic plan, which can kind of either complement or diverge from the college. Not all colleges have that, and some colleges, I wouldn't want to speak on their behalf, but I know from experience that some college student associations would struggle in that situation, as Kirsten has explained, because of that nature of being essentially a department within the college.
Helpful.
Alex, are you wanting to come in?
I think from a student point of view, it's quite difficult at the moment because there's not a lot of face-to-face contact. Emails don't portray emotion, so you've got no way of kind of showing how disappointed or angry or upset you are at things, and just the sheer lack of face-to-face time is difficult.
Thank you very much. Nicole?
That, I am a staff member in the college. However, I am supported to have discussions and difficult discussions with the principal and the executive leadership team on areas that the Student Association disagrees on, and they're absolutely open to listening to their view and having open discussions. And I think that it's about those partnerships and relationships that's really important, and how you respect each other and how you support each other with your different priorities.
I guess that comes to your point. If you're just first new in the door as a student, it can be quite daunting, isn't it? I think that's something that's challenging for us all. Michael, and sorry, Ruth.
I'm just keen to hear from Heather, because obviously in the Highlands it's quite you've got a big spread there, and you spoke about the number of leaders that you had to engage with. So I'd be interested to hear your perspective on that.
From a personal perspective, I obviously engage mostly with the Vice Chancellor and Principal, who and the senior management team, who are fantastic in listening to us. They want open and honest conversation, and they're not afraid to be open and honest with us as well, which is nice. I don't feel like if I'm having a one-to-one with Todd, I don't feel like there's any barriers. It is just an honest conversation. When it comes to individual principals, I'm not sure how good I am to comment. I would have to go back and speak to my local officers, but I do think it varies depending on attitude. There are some principals that come to mind that I think are fantastic, and there are others that I can imagine would be a bit more barriers and challenging. Yeah. So I guess it does vary, but the regional team, above all that, is absolutely fantastic, and I can't fault them.
I think John wants to come in as well on that, Ruth.
Yeah. I think just coming back to talking about the importance of my point of view in challenging senior management or challenging principals, I think staff, this shows where staff are really important within the SA. because we do have to build up the relationships over the years. I mean, some student presidents are only here for 2 years at a maximum, but building that relationship as a staff member and the management knowing that we have to, our job, as Nicole said, is to make sure that we have the conversations that are sometimes difficult. And just recently there, when we were asking for the two-year process for the students to be in a sabbatical position for 2 years, they were difficult conversations, especially around about the funding going forward. And whether the conversations are difficult or not, we still have the conversations and the staff support within that, having to push student presidents to ask the questions. Now, staff will know that we're not asking the, I believe, building their relationships. They'll know that we're not asking the being challenging or being difficult to ask the questions. It's what has to be right, because it's the right thing to ask at that time. So supporting our student associations or sabbaticals from a staff point of view, we have to know that the questions are difficult to ask, but we are employed to do that and support the student association, especially going forward.
Thank you. Michael Mara.
I find this line of question and discussion actually really useful in terms of understanding the dynamics that are working. Obviously, colleges are facing a really significant set of challenges at the moment in the current budget year, and also the spending review that's been carried out by the Scottish Government, which is looking at 8% real terms cut in funding for colleges. I just wondered whether student officers have been involved in discussions with boards of management around those challenges in recent weeks. Is that something you've begun to talk about in terms of, you know, I know that locally in Dundee, my home city, that there are discussions about closure of courses and other issues because of the need to close that, you know, what the principal's described as a black hole in the finances. So I just wondered, Kirsten, is that kind of thing you've been involved in so far? Have those come across your desk?
We've been involved in discussions about that there might be staff cuts. Well, there will be, it's not there might be. And restrictions on funding, for example, at the moment we have three members of staff who work solely on mental health and wellbeing services in the college, who are funded by an SFC grant. Once that goes, they're not going to stay. Let's be honest, we're in a mental health crisis. We need those members of staff, so that's really, really worrying. And that, and a reduction in staff at the time where colleges are supposed to be at the heart of the pandemic recovery, it's I think it is quite a worrying thing. And I think we are aware and we're involved and we know what's going on, but it's less of a discussion, more that this needs to happen sort of thing, and more of an understanding from us than anything else.
Any other, Heather, is it something you've been involved in?
On a regional level, definitely. Those have come across my table. If they are brought to the local boards of management, I know that they will come to my local officers as well, because they're involved in all the discussions. They will see the papers. So, yeah, we have been pretty involved and been able to ask questions, etc. So, yeah.
And is it, so it's more on that basis than a kind of a discussion with you about, I mean, I suppose Kirsten's making an advocate and voice around students heard in terms of, at least here in the college as well, around, you know, if there's here's provision that we think we need to keep. Is it more at that kind of design level, or is it here's a bit of a fait accompli, here's a plan that we're going to develop, and then obviously you make your representations on that basis, or is it earlier stage?
So far in my experience, we haven't quite got to the what are we going to do about it. We're sort of just dealing with it if this happens, kind of. That's the kind of where it's been at the minute. But once it comes to that, I will be able to input, and my officers will be able to input as well.
Nicole?
Yes, our officers have been involved in these kind of discussions as well, and they are looking at forward planning. Our college obviously is impacted as well as across the sector with regards to student mental health and wellbeing. And I guess our college are just looking at initiatives that we can take in-house to help to support students. But funding is always necessary. It allows that additional layer. For example, you know, we were running Keep Yourself Well workshops throughout the summer, which are supporting students before they actually start college. So without that funding, that makes that not possible. However, we are looking at, as I said, a different initiatives like, you know, mental health support for men that can run throughout the college, supported by college staff. But funding is really necessary.
And Al, I think you wanted to come in as well on this.
Yeah, I suppose two parts to that. One is that in terms of student officers being involved, certainly from my experience, that student officers have been involved in those conversations, both at an immediate level of what happens right now, but also how is this going to pan out for the next few years? And I think that that is probably a good example of how the board of management has actually engaged with those officers and made sure that they feel part of that decision-making process. It is always really challenging because a lot of the initial cuts, funding which is ending essentially rather than something which is being completely taken away, are going to be frontline services for students. So I think that it's difficult for current officers to actually get their heads around exactly what that's going to look like going forward. So I think in the next couple of years, supporting those student officers to be involved in those conversations and ensure that the services are correct for current students is going to be vital.
Michael?
Possible to hear from maybe from Amy and Alex, just in terms of the same kind of question around involvement in those discussions.
I personally have not had any involvement in it at all. There's been nothing come through our student association for it.
Okay, thanks. And Amy, sorry, over to you now.
No, that's okay. Yes, we have had discussions on that, and it's come across our team where we've discussed at a team about, you know, the implications for us as the SA. We've also been able to open a channel that, you know, when news of cuts get to student level, that they're able to have that sort of consultation and that say so, and what might happen with, when it comes down to what's happening in their specific department. And just wanted to sort of pick up on a point that was made about the staff member being a really sort of key tool and being able to challenge decisions. You know, we still have the 1 year term at Dundee and Angus College, so there is a very, very quick turnaround of sabbatical officers, and having that staff member, which I think we've had for 4.5 years now, I think has been influential in where we've been able to grow and become more sustainable. Sorry.
Thank you, Amy. Michael, are you okay? Can we bring in Graham Day, who's online, and he can ask some questions to the table today. Thank you, Graham. Over to you.
Yeah, thank you, convener, and apologies to the panel for not being present in person. I just want to go back a little bit and look at the challenges that are faced by student officers and staff in relation to colleges post-regionalisation. Because obviously, with regionalisation, we saw college mergers and multiple campuses come under the same umbrella. I want to explore, if I may, with you, the challenges that that can pose. I don't mean specifically in terms of the time that the relevant people have to dedicate to each campus, but more from the point of view of, I think John talked about culture, different cultures in different colleges or campuses, but also, for example, travel issues that arise where courses are concentrated in one particular location, which presents difficulties. And I think particularly where there is a mix of urban and rural campuses. Yes, I am being parochial when I represent Angus. So I just want to tease out a bit more about that if we can. And maybe Amy's the starting point here.
We'll send it to Amy first, but if not, Kirsten's happy to contribute as well. So over to you, Amy.
Thank you. Yeah, so I live very rurally myself, so I did find that, you know, getting to campus, we have our courses spread across most of them, but there are a couple of courses that are only available at Arbroath or only available in Dundee. So it is how we make sure we're supporting the students that, you know, might have to travel 50, 60, 70 miles from Stonehaven, you know, through on the bus services right through to Dundee, and making sure that they have plans in place to make them feel like they have to be 5 minutes late every day because of the bus times, that, you know, that understanding, they've had that conversation with their lecturers and they're not penalised because that's the first bus, things like that. So I do feel like when it's come to digital or, you know, online learning as well, and thankfully my Wi-Fi signal's held up today, but that was a real sort of barrier for a lot of our students as well, with lack of devices or lack of sufficient Wi-Fi to be able to sort of engage in their learning properly. And that has taken a lot of time to unpick, but we are thankful that we've been able to sort of get our hands on sort of external funding to get devices or have those conversations where the students don't feel like they're limited in any way.
Thanks, Amy. Can we head over to Kirsten now?
Yeah, so I have a couple of points to make. In terms of, in response to the question about culture, I think because NESCOL has three very different full campuses and very different learning centres, we don't really have a NESCOL culture. We have a culture at each campus, but we don't really have a culture across the region, and I don't think that will ever be the case. Our students are so different, and we try, you know, staff members travel from each campus, students' associations travel from each campus, and we try to have cross-campus events, but I just don't think it's ever going to work. Our students are so different, and I'm sure it's very similar, for example, at HISA. And in terms of availability of courses, some of our courses, at least pre-pandemic, and now because online it's a little bit different, but they would happen at the City Campus in Aberdeen, and students from Fraserburgh, for example, would attend virtually. So they're not getting the same quality experience as the students in Aberdeen. And there were also, you know, problems with Wi-Fi and things like that. These days, a lot of these classes are still occurring online, although there is hope to go back to the previous model at least somewhat. The fact is now that the students are kind of getting the same experience, but some of these students are being taught by lecturers who live over an hour's drive away. The only way they can talk to them is by email. I can go and speak to my lecturers on campus because I'm at the City campus, so they're not getting the same provision. And of course, availability was something I wanted to touch upon as well. If you live in Glasgow, for example, and you want to take a course, you have three different colleges to choose from. If you want to take a course in Aberdeen, you have one college to choose from. If you live in Banff, you have one college to choose from, and it might only be available in Aberdeen. I think there's certainly not an equal opportunity across the country. And very lastly, in terms of what's happened in the pandemic, one of the things that I've looked at this year is the benefits of hybrid learning. And I think somebody else touched upon it. I can't quite remember who. But one of the benefits that we've discovered is that some students are able to attend college because they can learn online, and they would never have been able to do that before. And that's something I've worked on this year to try and encourage NESCOL to keep that on board, at least have an option to attend some classes virtually that you wouldn't otherwise be able to attend, much like they do in universities. So I think that's something we really need to keep going forward.
Graham, I was wondering. Okay, thanks. I've got a question that follows on nicely from that, Kirsten. There might be other panel members that want to respond to Graham's questions, perhaps yourself, Heather. But in terms of that online and that hybrid model, I suppose I've got, you know, it's great to hear that it's a benefit to you, some of your students, but I've also got concerns that it's been driven perhaps by the colleges and it's not at the best interest of the students and they're losing out on that campus experience. So I was interested in your views of what do you think in terms of how has that been driven and presented as how you're going to learn going forward? So Heather, perhaps, and then Kirsten.
When we talk about culture at UHI, we have 13 different cultures because we have 13 different campuses and a vast amount of locations. And then on top of that, over 70 learning centres. We stretch from Shetland all the way down to Campbelltown. So when you talk about culture, it's quite vast at UHI, but I enjoy that. I think that's a beautiful part of UHI. When it comes to course availability, we're currently going through a curriculum review. I know that a vast amount of courses are available at pretty much every campus, but we do have campuses that specialise in different topics. We have been doing a hybrid model since before the pandemic, so I know that there are VC learning suites in a lot of campuses, so people could come in to a class, but you could also attend online. We have a mixed response from students. Some students love that because they have such busy lives or they live so rurally. Some students want that, but they also want a social experience. Wi-Fi, again, is also an issue. There's a chatter around if you should have your camera on during lectures, and some of our students just can't because of their Wi-Fi quality. They have to have their camera off, otherwise they keep getting kicked out of their call. For example, infrastructure is a big thing in the Highlands and Islands. As we know, we have students that take ferries to get to their class every day. It is vastly complex with its own unique set of issues, but it is what it is.
Thanks. Can we go to Kirsten and then Alex to respond to the hybrid?
I think there is a belief between students and lecturers at the college that it is driven by the college, and I think there is an aspect of that. I mean, some of the courses have been delivering online lectures to over 100 students at a time, which would obviously never have happened before the pandemic, and if it had, there would have been enough time to for that lecturer to meet one-on-one with those students. That just isn't the case now, whether it be via Teams or whether it be in person. I think it's a fine line between making sure that online availability, whether it be hybrid or fully online, is provided in a way that it benefits the students and staff but doesn't overload the lecturers, because if it overloads the lecturers, it undermines the student experience. And Heather's point about cameras, that's been an issue at NESCOL as well. Some lecturers have said, if you don't put your camera on, we're not going to mark you here, which is really not okay. And it comes down to privacy, I think, especially. I know there's the Wi-Fi issue, and that's by the by. But some people have things going on in the background. And also, you wouldn't invite your lecturer into your home generally, so you shouldn't have to have your camera on. I think another thing as well is we have to accept that a number of students who are coming to college are coming as like a last chance saloon and might have other things going on in the background that would restrict them from turning on their camera and therefore attending the lecture or whatever it is they're attending online.
Thanks. Alex, over to you now.
For myself personally, I'm a swap student. So most of the people in my class, for example, were fairly grown up. We've all got families. Luckily, at Fife College, there's quite a good scheme where they were giving us laptops and netbooks and things. But we had technical issues. All the way through the college year, there's been a green screen issue with the Google Chromebooks. So we've struggled with that. Some students have had to come out of lessons because they can't see the whiteboard that's been shared, etc. For me personally, the driven issue has been tutor-led or lecturer-led. They've decided. Some lecturers have said, I'm not going to teach online as soon as they were really able to, which meant on some occasions we were travelling in for an hour's lecture or a two-hour lecture. I personally suffer from mental health issues. The idea of getting on public transport absolutely terrifies me for lots of different reasons. So I missed a lot of lectures when I had vehicle trouble. So the option, I personally think the option should be there for the student, whether they want online, or I think it should be an either or, not you must do one or you must do the other. I think it would just open up the whole concept and make it so much more available for so many more people.
Thank you, Alex. And John online, John O'Hara.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just to add in that during that process, when we were working online in the pandemic, that the kind of help from Sparks at that time, using the toolkit for learning engagement to be able to gather that evidence during that time where students were working from home, which was really crucial for us at New College Lanarkshire, because towards the end of that, it was the higher national, the evidence that came out of that, that kind of gathering that evidence during that time from students and reps and the Student Association were a huge part of that, was actually there was a really like kind of mid-length bar, like, so there was HN students were really positive about online learning and they could really learn and they were really up for it. But actually when you look at lower courses, that some of the mostly practical courses were really about, and you can see the point in that where they had to learn practically to be able to complete their course, so they couldn't, some of them makeup artistry students that couldn't work on each other face to face, but doing that course online hybrid just wouldn't be able to go forward for them to complete their course. But we really did have a kind of a really positive look at some of the online courses going forward, and I think that evidence is really good to be able to plan for us to be able to help going forward. But I think we need to look at, I think, down into the actual courses that we deliver, hybrid, will they work, will they not work, especially practical courses, which a lot of FE colleges have put a lot of practical courses going forward. So, but the HN courses, definitely, and the ones that don't have less practical element to them, definitely work better for us as a college.
Thank you, John. And then over to Amy online as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I think with our students, it has, like John said, it's been a bit of a mixed bag of, you know, who's thrived for online learning, who's struggled. I was a hairdressing student, so that is, you know, quite tricky to learn over a Teams call. And I think what we've been doing is looking at it at that department level, seeing what has worked, speaking to the students about it, and is there aspects of that are, for example, the hairdressing course that could stay online, maybe the odd theory class, but that it gets sort of bolstered again in the practical learning. But I think it is going to be that flexibility of the delivery that will help. I don't think we've not got it set as, you know, 80% on campus. There's not a number. It is very sort of fluid from department to department. I think the one thing that's been said is that they will all have an opportunity to come onto campus if, you know, if they want. I know a few classrooms have been set up for that very sort of hybrid in and out sort of learning where people can call in as and when they need to. And I think that flexibility will be key to help those, you know, with, as the other person said, about mental health, about travel, and that security of going forward.
Thank you. Does anyone? Nicole?
Students enjoy, well, our students enjoy being on campus. We've had a majority of our students on campus, but we deliver a lot of practical courses. And in addition to that, our FE students need the social interaction in order to build relationships, in order to build relationships with peers and their lecturers, and feel supported with their mental health academically. And as I said, in addition, the peer support. So for us, I guess it's really important that the colleges are looking at individual courses and seeing the needs of their students and really listening to that. And I feel that, you know, our college has done that. We conducted a survey in the Student Association and we got a real mixed response. We had a lot of student carers. We had a lot of students, as I said, that have poor mental health problems, Wi-Fi issues, but like to be on campus. So I think it's really important that it's course-led and understanding the students that are actually participating in those courses and their needs individually.
Go to Al and to respond, and I think Michael has a question. You want to? Al, over to you.
Yeah, I think we've hit upon two very large challenges for students at Scotland's colleges. One is digital access and digital poverty. And I know that that's something which has been talked about a lot over the pandemic. But it is a real challenge for students. It's not necessarily an answer just to put a course online, because it does throw up other challenges that need to be planned and support needs to be put in place, and that's not always the case from day one. The other is travel more generally. We talked about different campuses and travelling in and out, as Alex said, for one-hour classes and then the rest were online. Travel has always been a challenge for students, regardless of the pandemic. It has been a barrier to education, and even in my own institution, being, you know, a city institution, travel from one local authority to another for a specific course is a challenge. You know, we've been lucky within the Student Association that we have been able to access funding to run a project around active travel and supporting students to access the best forms of public transport, etc. Unfortunately, that funding's coming to an end and we won't be able to do that any longer, but but supporting students to get to the course that they need to do is definitely a challenge. And I think that digital can solve some of those problems, particularly we look at the demographic of students that are coming through. A lot of students are coming back into education. A lot of students have family commitments and caring responsibilities. So it is, as McCall says, about making sure that those students in that particular course get their voices heard and how that is delivered, and make sure that it works for everybody.
Thank you. Kirsten, you want to?
There's been a few very good points raised, and it led me back to something that I've done this year. I conducted a survey with the student body about how they would like to learn. I think it was something that was really, really important that we had to ask, and we also followed on from that with focus groups. And a lot of the kind of younger students have said exactly what Nicole said, that they need to be there for that social aspect. And 47% of the students surveyed said that they struggled with their mental health learning online. But also we had, you know, 34% of the students who said they preferred to learn online and 55% who said they prefer that flexible mixed approach. You know, lots of students have said it's easier for childcare, it's easier if they have care and responsibilities, they can't afford to come to college, we're in a cost of living crisis. And most students have said, the focus groups are kind of just being collated now, but what people have said is they want a mixed approach, they want the opportunity to have both, because they find it so much easier to manage other responsibilities. And in terms of technology, most of our students have said that's not an issue, although that's, you know, there is still a percentage of that that say it's difficult, but the college does really, really support them. The only issues that they have are maybe kind of on a operational level where things maybe don't go quite to plan. But in terms of being able to access online classes, but also have the option to learn on campus, that's really what our students want. And I think, you know, our sample for a Students Association survey was quite big. It was 216 people, but, you know, we have 21,000 students. That's, you know, we need support from perhaps a college or someone else needs to run the survey. So we need to make sure on a higher level, because that represents a very small sample, although a big sample for a Students Association survey. It would be useful to do that again, I guess, on a regional or a national level.
Thank you. Michael, you've got some questions.
I think this area is really interesting in terms of the next phase post-pandemic, you know, and balancing those models. And it sounds like it's something that you're all kind of struggling with or actually addressing and engaging with really proactively, which is great to hear. I suppose I wonder about how attractive going to campus is. I mean, Al's mentioned how challenging that can be in terms of travel costs and so on. You know, are the kind of campuses that you're running, are they places that people want to be? And is that work that's been done? I mean, college principals tell me there's no capital budget. You know, they've got no money to do the transition to net zero. They're worried about, you know, again, locally to me, Kingsway campus in Dundee. You know, Gardines had a lot of money spent on it, but, you know, there's a kind of a worry that actually are these places that we can attract people to? Is there a gym that people can use? You know, is there childcare facilities there? So is that a job that colleges have to do more of to attract people back and make these places they want to go?
Alex, would you be able to kick that one off?
Personally, yeah, I would be attracted to... I'm at Carnegie campus, so there's no gym. There is childcare facilities, but it's for young children. As I said, I'm a swap student, so most of us are parents. So half the month I'm a single father. I've got three kids, so I have to get my kids to school as well as get myself to college. So the flexible learning is good for that. Yes, I do enjoy being on campus. I enjoy spending the time with my peers, actually face-to-face with the lecturers. But at the same time, again, with my mental health issues, a busy campus for me is a terrifying prospect. So the flexibility is fantastic. I can pick when I think the college is going to be busy. If it's not busy, I can find a quiet place to go and sit and do the lecture online. So I'm not stuck. I'm free to kind of work to my own abilities, if that makes sense.
Thank you, Alex. And Nicole, you wanted to come on this?
Yeah, I was going to say it is really important, and our college has actually redeveloped the whole bottom floor of the main building to make it more student-friendly due to student feedback. We offer all students free lunch and free breakfast when they come onto campus. We have a free gym for students, and we're redeveloping an outdoor space for students as well. And I think all of those elements are really important for an overall community feel and for them to actually create relationships. And I think that's a big part of students actually coming back to college, is making friends and feeling part of a community before they actually go into employment. And I think, you know, colleges have to look at all of those elements. It's not just about the course, which is really important. It's about ensuring that our colleges have placements for students so that they're employment ready. It's about having the facilities in our college that support our students while they're there. It's about having staff support that can help the person and look for a real person-centred approach. So colleges are saying, we actually care about you as a person, we care about your journey, and we care about you and where you're going to go and progress on.
Al, you said you wanted to come in on this.
Yeah, I think there's a good example at Edinburgh College of the social care course, which again was delivered across four campuses. but it's being consolidated broadly within one campus, with some at a second campus. But it's about the facilities that those students can access when they're on campus. So it's about what's the quality of student experience when you're on campus. Are you just coming to sit in a, you know, completely anonymous classroom that you could do anywhere? Or are you actually accessing expert facilities? The social care course, the department that's been developed at Sight Hill is incredible. It's award-winning and all the rest of it. And it's great for students to be able to have that practical element within their course rather than just totally theory-based in a classroom and then punted out to placement. They've got that in-between bit where they can actually experience what it's like and learn mistakes through that process before they go out on placement. It makes them more confident. But what you've hit upon again is that those kind of wraparound things, unfortunately, are the things that which are first to go whenever budgets are tight. So it is that although it's great to see investment in facilities for specific courses, facilities for social spaces and access to those sorts of things are not necessarily a priority for all colleges at the minute because of the budget constraints, and that's definitely an issue. And it's something which we feel as a student association that we have to kind of plug that gap and provide those activities.
Heather wants to come in and then John online. Okay, thank you, Heather.
Thank you. I think for us it's we have campuses that have amazing facilities, top of the range, our larger ones, but we also have much smaller campuses that are essentially offices and some classrooms and you don't have anything else. The big thing we've been hearing from our students is they want that flexibility. What's key for them is to feel welcome on campus. I had a student tell me just yesterday that their entirely online course, they didn't feel welcome at their own campus and they had to find their own way to feel that essentially. They had to force themselves to come on campus, to go to the library, to meet people in order to feel welcome. So I think that there's an issue around that. If we have just online, do our students feel part of the community? Do they feel welcome at their own campus? And I think whilst flexibility is key, we still need to address that social aspect that people want to see other people and be around other people. And that's been really key for our students.
Thank you, Heather. John?
Yeah, I just want to make a point of just talking about how attractive the services are to students and when they're on campus. I mean, over the years that I've worked at in education, I think we're aware that the student that comes through the door now has more complex needs than before. The wraparound services are really, really important. And I think the wraparound services are more attractive to students than actually a classroom or something else within the college, especially in my experience. So when we're talking about cuts and the future, we need to really make sure that we're putting that at the forefront, that that we have the wraparound service and that we're looking at actually the needs of the students going forward.
And lastly, Amy wants to come in on this as well. Over to you, Amy, online.
Thank you. What I feel is a big part of making the campus attractive is the people that are there. The people that are there, as has been said, that are going to welcome people. That more informal wraparound, whether it's lunchtime clubs, breakfast clubs. So much happens at college that is out with the classroom and out with that academic sort of space. And I think that is a huge part of the whole college experience for our students. So whether it's during the pandemic, when we were allowed, we were bringing the opportunity for all our campuses to come together, whether it was for picnics or walks and things like that. And it was creating that across the board culture, where I think that on the across board community, which I think it wasn't necessarily a counselling session or a wellbeing session. It was just a social opportunity where people got to meet face to face, have experiences together, make those friendships and those relationships. And that's something we're keen to continue. And just to echo what other people said, it's a big worry of where the cuts are going to affect that, because we know that that's probably going to be the resources that will be cut first.
Thank you, Amy. And Oliver Mundell on this topic.
Thanks. Thank you, convener. Heather kind of touched upon it in terms of the consistency of investment across smaller campuses. That was something I was interested in, whether it was uniform or whether smaller campuses tend to miss out. And there was a second question, particularly on those smaller campuses, whether the staff are always there, because that's something I've had in feedback, is that, you know, it's not just about students being on campus, with the kind of move towards more kind of digital delivery, that at smaller campuses there's often not teaching staff present, or they're sort of beamed in from other sites. Is that something you've experienced?
I think it very much does vary across the region. One of our campuses, for example, has never reopened. It's still shut entirely, and it's entirely online. Having been around a few of them, I think you tend to find that the support staff are there. Lecturers, I'm not entirely sure. I would have to come back to you on that one. I think the larger campuses are feeling that they are quite busy again, but the smaller campuses are still feeling a bit empty and a bit quiet, but that could be lower student numbers, for example. But it does, I think, vary vastly across the region.
Is that something other people have experienced as well, or particularly, I was interested in, certainly in the staff point, whether or not teaching staff are present on smaller campuses, or whether there's now a sort of move to beam people in to teach.
Kirsten, have you? If you don't have any experience of that, you don't, yeah.
No, I don't think I have that.
That's fine, okay. Anyone else? That's okay, I'm just checking the chat. Amy, was that you wanted to come in on that point? Yes, it is. Sorry, yeah, 2 hours in a row. Crack on, Amy, sorry.
Sorry. So I think Gardine is one of our biggest campuses, but it's also our campus that had the more sort of theoretical or academic-based subjects. So to start with, we did find that there was less people coming back on campus because they were still all doing remote delivery, whereas Kingsway and Arbroath are slightly smaller campuses, but they are all very, very practical-based subjects, so they did get the buzz about campus back a lot quicker. I do still think that Gardine is slightly quieter because of that as well, coming back now.
I think Stephanie has a... Oliver, are you...
Yeah, I'm happy.
Stephanie Callaghan has a point on this matter to bring up as well.
Just a wee supplementary question, kind of going back to what we were talking about in the first place there. I'm wondering, it seems to be that for students that wraparound support and the wellbeing seems to be a real key priority for students. That seems to be what they're really looking for. So kind of going back to students' views having parity, what power have they got? Have students then got the power to insist that boards and principals then make this a priority for their colleges? Do you have the power to do that? Thanks.
Nicole, are you in a position to answer that?
Yeah. I would say absolutely. And our officers have taken that to the board, and they've been really clear on, I guess, their discussions and their feedback from students. And our college is making it a priority. As I said, you know, funding obviously is really helpful, and there is now a lack of funding. Funding is stopping in some aspects. But they are really keen to draw resources from other areas of the college in order to support students, because it's really necessary. You know, there's a lot of students that have been impacted by the pandemic, by loss of jobs, and lots of other things that are going on in their lives. And I think it's really important that colleges do understand that, and ours definitely does, whether it's internally putting on support mechanisms. However, funding allows, I guess, a wider expanse of that, and we can do bigger, better things with more funding.
Kirsten, and then John online. Okay.
I think NESCOL really have tried to invest in improving the spaces that we have available for students on campus. And as students come back, you know, we're seeing that they appreciate, you know, music on campus, TVs, nice places to sit. Although our campuses, especially Aberdeen City Campus, it doesn't have a lot of room for social spaces, so it's really difficult to create that. But the college really are investing in improving social spaces and improving wellbeing services. But like I said before, the staff that we have there who are supporting students with mental health or wellbeing problems, and the counselling service that we have, I'm not sure if that's going to continue when the SFC grant goes. And I think that that's a real concern for the college and for students' associations.
Thank you, Kirsten. John, online, over to you. John O'Hara.
Yeah, just to add in that I think that the student associations, especially in New College Lanarkshire, should be really confident in bringing up that agenda. And also, I think a huge part of working on the student mental health agreement, along with the college as well, allows us to be able to better put in place what the colleges are at, what the students are actually needing. So working together in partnership in that student mental health agreement, I think, is our way forward to see actually what do the students need and what the college is going to do to be able to support that student.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. And now we're going to move to some questions that Bob Dorris is looking to ask the panel. Thanks.
Thanks very much, convener. I've been really interested in hearing about the varied experiences across the country, but one of the aims of regionalisation was to make it easier and more straightforward for young people to move from school into the college sector, be it HND, HNC, HND or foundation apprenticeships, for example, but also from colleges into universities, whether that is moving straight to second year at university and articulating from college to university. So I suppose I want to know whether the student experience has been that things have improved in recent years in relation to both those things. And just finally, convener, also that there's an equality of status between if you're at college you do a HND because that's what you need, but it's not a self-fulfilling prophecy, you have to go to university, but you go for the HND or you go for the apprenticeship. So that equality of status across various courses as well. So any comments on that at all, convener, would be very welcome.
Thank you, Bob. I think Nicole would like to kick off this one. Thanks.
Yes, our college has increased the articulation routes and we now have more than 200 articulation routes and agreements with universities, which has been fantastic and a real increase with that. In addition to that, we work very closely with our local schools. We might be slightly different from the bigger college. We're a medium-sized college. We're in one region. We're not split across different campuses. So we can really build and develop those relationships across the sector and support our students. We work with organisations like Skills Development Scotland to provide careers advice for students who are coming in, and they have one-to-one support for them if they change their mind mid-course or if they don't want to go to university. And obviously we work with employers and we work with the SWAP programmes as well. So it's really, really important that we look across the wider community and understand the needs of our employers and what's available with regards to further education and higher education and how we can interlink with schools as well.
And I think, Al, you want to come in on this as well?
Thanks, convener. I think the three things on this. One is our, from Edinburgh College perspective, the Schools-College Partnership Programme at Edinburgh College has really boomed over the last few years, and particularly for Edinburgh College, that means the college is then working with three different local authority areas, so three different groups of schools within that. School pupils getting the experience of being on campus and learning subjects that they wouldn't have access to through school. So that's been a real success. The other area, I suppose, at the other end is, as Alex has attested to, the SWAP programme, students who sign up to a programme who they know will end up in university has been very positive. Edinburgh College, I think, let me get this marketing speak correct, is the biggest single provider of students to Edinburgh's universities. So there's a huge proportion of our students go on to universities in Edinburgh. But also the HND level courses, retention and attainment levels within those courses is really high, and it's been consistent for a long time. So I think that proves that, like you were saying, that people come to college to achieve an HND in its own right, and it is seen as a qualification that is can help them in their career. So certainly from our point of view, those three things would be very positive.
Okay.
That helps.
We also have Alex over there. Would want to come in on this. Thanks.
Yeah. SWAP students, there's quite a high proportion of us go on to university. Every one of my classmates has achieved a university place that they've been looking for. Like myself, I've come back into education after, 20-odd years? So I've struggled a little bit to get back into the way. The advice that was given to me and the help that's been given to me, the lectures that have been set up by the guidance staff and the tutors have been fantastic. It's definitely led by, for us, I think Carnegie campus is quite a small campus, so it's quite a student-led, but it's been a fantastic experience from start to finish.
Thank you.
Bob?
Yes, if there's any other comments on that, it would be welcome, but I'd one final thing I'd wanted to ask about, because another aspect of regionalisation was we wanted to make sure that when you have a consolidated college with a number of campuses, that community outreach work to attract learners that wouldn't normally go to college. So I'm not talking about those at school now, but those in the wider community that otherwise haven't had a conventional learning pathway, would be the jargon, I suppose. Hard-to-reach groups would be other jargon. But what work is ongoing, and has that been enhanced in any way by college regionalisation? How do we reach those students who wouldn't normally get into learning? Because that's, of course, what we're further education sectors there for as well. So any comments on that would be really welcome.
Okay, over to you, Nicole.
Sorry, I was going to say we've created in our college programmes like the Trust Project, which is looking for students that maybe have come from a trauma-informed background and not quite ready to go into mainstream full-time education courses, and they're brought in. In addition to that, we have skills boost courses and the Young Persons Guarantee. So again, it's reaching out across our community, our local community, for students that maybe wouldn't come through school routes naturally or wouldn't apply to college, and saying, look, you know, college is for everybody. You know, even if you don't feel ready to do a full-time course, there's a stepping stone into college, and come along and find out about it.
Thank you very much. I've got Amy online that wants to come in as well on this.
Thank you. It's just answering a couple of questions from before, Bob, as well. So we've got our senior phase programme that's run through our academic development team. And just recently, and ongoing, we've got the S3 Open Days, who will be our sort of future senior phase. They're coming in for taster sessions now before their choices need to be made, getting a good experience on campus. Again, getting to meet the different support teams as well that they'll have available to them when they're on campus as a student. So it's really bolstering that community feel and that support from the get-go. I don't know the number for how many sort of articulation routes they've got. I've got COVID at the minute, so I've got a bit of brain fog. But I do know that they have increased, and we have a number of the swap courses as well. When it comes to sort of the quality of the status, we kind of promote that there's no wrong path, whether it's linear, whether it's, you know, a bit of a roller coaster. If you're coming in to do something that's going to progress you as a person, your confidence, your learning, then you do what you need to do, whether that's you stop it, you know, that HE or FE, whatever you need to do as a person. And when it comes to sort of reaching those most disengaged, our learning engagement team, again, the name of the project's lost in my head, but they go into sort of community groups, young mum groups, to carers groups, to really reach those people, and give them that opportunity, that point of contact to, you know, plant that seed about education and coming back, and they're fully supported in that role. And I know they've been really successful across the board.
Thank you. And Kirsten, you want to comment on this?
In relation to your first point, we, like Amy at Dundee and Angus, have at NESCOL, we have taster sessions on at the moment for school pupils to come and to experience college and to see what it's like. Because I think, from a personal level, I think we have a culture problem in Scotland where college is seen as secondary to university. And it's seen as, you know, if you go to college, it's not equal status to university. And actually, I think all of us would agree that college is a great place to go, and a lot of students flourish at college where they wouldn't maybe in school, fifth and sixth year, or at university. They might think they're ready in grades, but they might not be ready in other ways, and college is a really supportive environment for those kind of students. And I think we have a number of articulation routes, and the universities come to the college and they say, this is what we've got to offer, this is how we can support you as a college student. And I think the college really helps to create that equality of status and to remind college students that you're just as able as the university students. And so do the teams at the universities who help with the widening participation. And in relation to your question about other students, I don't think that university and college experiences are open to everyone. Funding for SAS hasn't increased for a number of years, and I think number of people feel that they can't afford to go to university, they have to, or college, and they have to, in terms of articulation, I mean, and you know, they think, well, I'll have to work full time alongside it. I can't afford it. I've got kids. I've got this. I've got that. So college isn't open to everyone, and we have to be aware of the fact that we're in a cost of living crisis. And if people are going to choose college or whatever, they need more money.
Thank you. I'm looking around if anyone else wants to come in on that. Are you okay now, Bob?
Thank you.
So, are you okay? Do you want to say anything else, Alex?
Just an issue on funding. I come from full-time work into education. Was given some not very good advice at the start. So as a result, the right funding wasn't in place for myself. I wasn't getting enough funding. Essentially, I was getting £240 a month to live off. 75% of my rent was being paid as a result, because I live in a private let. As a result, I'm now in quite a lot of substantial debt. Luckily for myself, I'm ex-military, so a lot of the military charities are now helping me out. But for somebody coming off the street, off a full-time education, or sorry, off a full-time employment and a full-time education, there's not a lot of advice and there's not a lot of funding available for us. For example, you can't get a bursary if you're claiming universal credit. You can't claim universal credit if you're a full-time student. It's very complicated.
Okay.
And I think that really needs to be addressed.
Thank you, Alex. And COCAB, you've got some supplementaries on this, I believe.
Yes, thank you, convener. It was about the... I'm interested in the parity of esteem for all the different courses and things, and it was good to hear about the widening participation routes. As part of that, I suppose, if a student is doing and choosing any of those routes, how well prepared do you think the students feel to take the next steps, whatever that may be for them? So I think you've sort of demonstrated that, by and large, they're able to sort of like choose different routes. But how well prepared do they actually feel for that? Are they nervous? Are they apprehensive? Are they supported? Do they get the advice from the right people at the right time? Is there anyone that would particular?
Yeah. I think we have Alex is nodding to me that he might be able to go first on this one.
As a student, yes. At Fife College, the advice is there. The help's there from the tutors. I've been really fortunate. The tutors I've had are fantastic. And they've been able to say, yes, that's the path for you. No, that's not the path for you. And suggest other routes if it's not necessarily what they think you're capable of doing. So, yeah, the help and advice is there.
Thank you, Alex. And Al, and then McCall.
Yeah, very quickly, just say I think that one thing that colleges in Scotland are particularly good at is links with industry. And I think having that work-based learning approach and having the ability to give students a taste of what their working life could look like is essential for a lot of our students, and it helps them in the next step to make those decisions whether they need further qualifications or they can access direct employment after there.
Thank you. Nicole?
Yes, actually, I agree with Alan. We're exactly the same. And we've just done a survey as a student association to our students. We had 1,000 responses, and 78% of them said that they felt ready for the next progression routes, and that they were able to speak to their staff, and their staff had spoken to them at the beginning of the course and obviously through their course. I think it's really necessary to have a person-centred approach as well, because people can change their minds halfway through. They maybe don't want to do that type of career, or they've gone in a placement that they've not enjoyed. So I think it's really important that they have that relationship with not just their lecturer, but with the college, and that they know the facilities are available, like the career support, like the student advice that they can access any time should they change their mind or should they wish just to know what steps are next. Again, I also think that they take into consideration the money side of things. You know, can they afford to progress on to university? Can they afford to go on to the next course? And what does the college do to support them? And I think it's really, really important that they have that relationship and communication, and staff, support staff are there to support their journey while they're at college.
Thank you, Nicole. And Amy online, Amy Monks.
So just from my personal experience, I do feel like I was very supported in my next steps. There was obviously, with it being a practical course, I missed out on so much practical learning. There was still nerves there, but what I think has been amazing from my experience of people in my class was that the lecturing staff are still there for us. If there is any questions or, you know, we've made a little bit of advice, we still feel really comfortable and confident to go back and say, can you just maybe remind me of this aspect or anything like that? And I do think, you know, coming back out of the pandemic, having the work experience back in the industry talks, and like we said there, the careers and that sort of business gateway, all those sort of external resources as well that can be pulled upon, really, really support our learners for, you know, whether they're going on to university or like myself and a lot of practical courses, it stops at college or going, you know, out into the workplace.
Thank you, Amy. Heather.
Thank you. Yeah, I think at UHI we have a fantastic careers team who put on skills workshops. Every student has, there's variations of the name, but a personal academic tutor that they can go to for advice. I think being unique as well in the case that we are tertiary, you don't necessarily have to leave UHI to take that next step. You could, what I love about UHI personally is you can enter with no qualifications whatsoever and you could leave with a PhD. So I think it does look slightly different for our students, especially if you are somewhere rural or an island, for example. You could go right the way through UHI. So moving on to degree level, for example, might be slightly less intimidating because you don't have to leave. You've got the same people around you that whole time. You've got the same career service, the same support staff available to you. And I think that makes it potentially slightly easier.
Thank you, Heather. And Kirsten.
Going back to the parity of experience question, I think the students who are progressing to university feel very well prepared. The universities are there from the very beginning. They're there at the open days. They come and speak to the students. They're there at workshops. The student advice team runs skills workshops to help you write UCAS statements and things like that. I think our students who are studying practical courses, specifically things like construction, engineering, I don't think they feel as well prepared, although I think part of my experience, all of my experience comes from COVID years, so I think that's part of the problem. They don't feel like they have enough practical experience. But also a number of our students have said they don't feel enough, they have enough support to get an apprenticeship or move to further work. So I think we do enough for kind of uni students. I think for our students progressing to uni, I think we need to do a bit more for students who are going on to a different kind of work.
Thank you. Co-cat.
Thank you. I'll just explore that a bit further then. So what suggestions could be given the students that you consult with? I was going to come on to the ones that may slip through the net because, you know, we want to be there for everybody, leave nobody behind. So what do colleges do to make sure that they catch everybody? And the ones that don't feel so prepared, do they feel that they can ask for that extra support? Are the colleges able to respond to that?
Kirsten, do you want to follow on?
Yes, so our student advice team, like I say, runs employer workshops and skills workshops, and students also have like a notice board where they can see the apprenticeships that are available. A student did suggest to me perhaps it would be a good idea to have employers come along to their classes so they could see what, you know, what they do and how they do it. He also, this particular student said to me that sometimes the students that get picked for apprenticeships are kind of cherry-picked. So perhaps that would be a good way to say who was capable. There was something else I wanted to add, but it slipped my mind.
You can come back. You can always send it in by email to us later if it comes to you. Nicole.
Do that. We work with a number of employers that come in and visit classes, and they develop relationships with students. In addition to that, their placements as well. And I think the key thing is that we listen to students. So if, for example, they don't turn up at class once or twice, you know, we've got a team that will follow that up. We want to find out what's the problem, is how we can support them as we go along, so that we can nurture our students and really help to support them with their journey. I was going to say as well, like a lot of the students had enjoyed the flexibility of COVID with regards to SQA, with continuous assessment and open book, and we're just hoping that that flexibility will kind of progress on as you know, COVID years are non anymore.
Thank you, Nicole. Okay, thank you. Can we move on now to some questions from Oliver Mundell?
Hi, thank you. Oh, sorry. Hi, thank you, convener. It was just to go back to the kind of earlier point on parity of esteem. I was just interested
to kind of get your views on whether you thought that in terms of policy coming from the Parliament and the Government, you that the message was strong enough in support of college education.
Okay. Anyone want to pick that one up to start? Al?
that's a difficult question to answer. I think that certainly the cuts that we're seeing in the college budget for this year and the coming few years is going to be a real challenge, but that's not to say that they're not also replicated in universities. I think the challenge for colleges is the restrictions that they have to react to those challenges. I won't speak for colleges. I'll let them make their own evidence on that. But I think the in terms of the students that come through colleges, we tend to see students from a real very background coming with real challenges or experiences that perhaps isn't necessarily replicated in universities. And I think that therefore the support that college students need can tend to be a lot higher in terms of particularly those students who need that extra additional support. The funding that's coming through for that support is not necessarily to the level that it needs to be within the college sector. I'll give the specific example of counsellors on campus. There was a lot of discussion about more counsellors required on campuses, both university and colleges, and money came through for that, and that has been a real development within the sector. Even at the height of that, colleges were still much less supported to provide that service, even though there was a much higher demand. So I think it is definitely something that needs ongoing support, because it's going to be a real challenge going forward with more cuts coming down the line. So I think the regionalisation project or the regionalisation of colleges is meant to make the sector more streamlined and more able to adapt to these challenges. But I think that the way in which colleges operate is very, very different to the way universities operate. And therefore, I think colleges do need, in a lot of ways, more support because they don't have that additional income coming through research funding, for instance. I hope that answers the question.
Do you want, no one else wanted? Oh, Kirsten does.
I think I mentioned it before, but I think it's less of a policy problem, more of a culture problem. As I said before, people think that college is secondary to university. And even in my own experience, I sat on an SQA working group this year, and I had to constantly say, to remind the people on the SQA group, it's not just school pupils that are doing SQA qualifications, there's also college learners. And to have to constantly remind the SQA just shows how much of a culture problem we have when they're at the heart of the education system.
Thank you, Kirsten. Oliver?
Yeah, I was going to say it won't come to a surprise to any of us on this committee, the sort of challenges you have in communicating that to the SQA. I just wondered if it goes wider, you know, to politicians, you know, and to the Parliament and government as well, whether you feel, you know, because I think we all say your college education, you know, is important and that colleges have a key role, but it's whether you think that the kind of political support is there to make parity of esteem real. But that's maybe a difficult
That's
question.
A big question. Yeah. Well, maybe might have to leave that one and they come back to it later if they need a bit of, or unless anyone wants to. No, I'm looking. No. I want food for thought. As I said, we can. If you have any thoughts on that, we might have time to pick that up at the end. Willie Rennie, over to questions from yourself now.
I think there's probably been a bit more of a positive view about college management in today's evidence session than there was last week with the trade unions. And I'm just wondering, you've probably observed that there's been quite a lot of industrial dissent and the industrial relations aren't particularly strong in the sector. And I'm just wondering if anybody's got a view on why that is and how you think we might be able to resolve that? Again, a big question, but it is different. The mood today is very different from last week, and I'm interested to why that is the case.
Great question, Willie. I'm looking around for... can I go to you, Al? I've caught your eye and I'm holding it.
Thanks, Convener. I think that the industrial action in colleges has been an issue throughout the regionalisation years, and particularly this year, we had strikes from lecturers for over a month, plus resulting boycotts. There was threat of industrial action from support unions as well, and I don't necessarily think that that's going to go away within the current funding packet that we have. Overall, throughout that period, real terms funding has been cut, but I suppose that will always have an impact. I think that the impact on the student experience is huge whenever industrial action takes place, because of the short life cycle of a student, and I'm not sure whether the current funding levels or the projected funding levels for the next few years is going to make that situation any better, and that is a concern for the student experience for sure.
Does anyone else want to come in comment on that? Looking online, Alex. Thanks.
The level of support from the tutors during that period massively dropped. They went, from my experience, they went from working, doing all the things that they do, all the extra stuff that they do for us, to doing exactly what was under contract for it. It was only a few weeks, but the level of support massively dropped off. From the point of view of a student, it wasn't a comfortable place to be in. You want to support the tutors, but at the same time, you've got this tiny period of time where you have to complete the course to move on to your next phase. And it was a really difficult few weeks.
Thank you, Alex. Amy. Over to you, Amy. Sorry.
Thank you. The impact on the refund on the students was a mix of, anger, upset. They've, again, of course, want to see their teaching staff in a good position and want to support them. But we even had students that were actually fearful to cross the picket line. I know Dundee's got a bit of a volatile history when it comes to industrial action in different places, and that was really, really, really sad to see that they feared to come to college and cross that picket line. And we had to reassure that, even though they may be taking industrial action, that they're still your lecturers, they're still the same people. They're obviously just putting up a fight where they're looking for that support. But that wasn't very nice to see.
Willie?
Let me be a bit more provocative.
Oh, dear.
When I was in higher education, student unions were a source of revolution and agitation, and I've not really picked that up today. I mean, the college sector has faced, 10 years' worth of cuts, the flat cash over the next few years, and 43,000 whole-time equivalent. Places have been lost over several years. And I'm just wondering why you're not angry and why you're not protesting.
Looking around. Okay, Kirsten. Thanks.
I think, again, it goes back to the forming good relationships in the college and being part of the college. But we are angry, and we've kind of gone through NUS, and NUS have said how angry we are about it. But whatever we do, it doesn't seem to make a difference. We're angry about the cuts, and we want to see education flourish, but whatever we say, we don't seem to get anywhere. We don't really know. I think we're at a brick wall now. And for example, within the industrial action with the lecturers, we completely agree with it, but at the same time, our education's being impacted, and unless there's a change in funding, nothing's going to happen. So it's kind of, you agree and you support it, but on the other hand, like Alex said, it wasn't such a problem at NESCOL, actually, but in other institutions, students are not having their assessments marked, and therefore they're having issues with progression. So they become angry at the wrong people because of that. You know, the problem is the funding. That's the problem.
Thank you, Kirsten. And Amy wants to come back in, then over to John. But Amy first, thank you.
Oh, no, I had to answer that, sorry.
Oh, sorry, that's... John.
Sorry. Yeah, I think I totally agree with Kirsten. I think looking at over the 10 years and how we've been cut constantly, but not sitting here angry doesn't take away that how passionate people are within student associations and what we believe in. We believe that student associations have to be funded going forward, and the reason behind they have to be funded going forward is because of the inevitable work that they do on the ground and these students do on the ground. And we believe in what we do, and we'll always, as a student union and as a student movement going forward, we'll always believe in what we do. But we are angry at times, but sometimes anger doesn't change anything. So what we do is we constantly fight the battle.
Heather, are you wanting to come in on this? You don't need to if you don't want to.
I think that, yeah, there definitely is still an anger there, but I've found in our case that being diplomatic about it often yields better results. We do have a really good relationship with the regional team at UHI, and often sitting down and having those discussions behind closed doors yields better results than standing up against them, because then there's a bit of an affront. So we work together to find the best solutions, and I've found that the senior management team at UHI undoubtedly does want the best result for students, and they do listen to us. They want to know how they can help and if they can help. And in the case of the cuts, I've seen them personally, how unhappy they are about it, and then the choices they're going to have to make. Like, they don't want to have to make those choices. So there is a bit of sympathy there as well.
And Amy has subsequently put an R in the chat bar, so we'll go back to Amy online. Thank you, Amy.
Sorry, yeah, I totally agree with Heather. I think it's how we channel that anger, and, you know, be really smart about, you know, the conversations we have. And I do think a lot does go on behind closed doors. We've written letters, we've, you know, made phone calls, we've done all the things, and it's how we team up with our exec to best approach things. I think the more people invested and behind that sort of fight, the better.
Thank you, Amy. Willie, do you have, is that okay? So last set of questions this morning is from Ross Greer. Over to you, Ross.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Not quite afternoon yet, and I promise it won't be the afternoon by the time I've finished these. I'm interested in continuing with Willie's line of question and what he was reflecting on there at the start, but the difference in tone here in terms of how you're talking about your relationships with college management and what we heard last week from the trade unions. I think it's fair to say the kind of evidence we were getting from the trade unions made it very clear that there's a fundamental lack of trust between unions and college management. We've not heard from management yet, but it'd be fair to say that goes both ways. There does seem to be more trust between yourselves and management. I've been interested in any reflections that you've got on that. But the first question that I've got is about your relationship with the unions, because you mentioned a lot about the ways in which you engage with college management. Do you have much regular contact with the lecturers' union, with the support staff unions? Is that part of your week-to-week activities as student associations, or does that all sit quite separate from the work that you do?
I'm looking around. Can anyone respond? Al, again, and then McCall, maybe?
Thank you. I can respond quickly to say that my experience is no. Student associations and trade unions do not work very closely together. Trade unions tend to work at a national level and work directly with NUS. At a local level, my experience is that trade unions will be in contact with the student association whenever there is industrial action. Out with that, not so much.
Thank you. Michael?
This is exactly the same as Al. But in relation to the student association working with college boards, I guess there's a different relationship because the student officers are actually living the experience. So maybe the board are more open to listening to their individual experiences and understanding of college life and be more open to I guess, creating strategy and elements to be able to support the student experience, because that is the key. We all want the same end goal. We all want to have students at the centre. We all want them to succeed. We want them to progress, and we want them to be the best that they can. So I guess that's maybe why there's a bit of a disparity.
Ross?
If I could continue about this theme of being provocative, and I mean, absolutely no offence by this, I stress, but before I ask it, but do you think that the difference in the relationship between unions and management, yourselves and management, is there any bearing on that from the fact that your relationship with management also involves the funding that student associations receive from colleges? Unions don't receive funding from college management, they receive membership dues. Do you ever feel that, the financial relationship compromises your ability to perhaps be a bit tougher in that relationship and a bit more combative?
So I've got Kirsten, and then Heather is keen to answer that. So Kirsten, over to you.
Absolutely. It would be really, really difficult for us to flat out publicly disagree with the college, whereas, you know, AIS Fila can just go out there and say, we don't agree with this, for example. And in relation to your first question, it would be, I think, useful for us to meet with trade unions on a regular basis. The only time that I met with any trade union reps outside of casual conversations with the staff I know that are union reps at the college was when NUS organised a meeting with us and the EIS Fila reps during the first instance of the strike, which was really useful, but it did turn into, I think because we don't have that regular contact with them, it turned into a bit of a you versus us, when really we all have the same end goal.
Thank you. Heather?
Yeah, I think our relationship with the UHI senior management team is a very productive one. They regularly refer to us as the experts on learning, so they want our opinion, and I think that is partially why it's so good. When it comes to funding, I don't feel it impacts us much. They want to see us as effective, and they were happy to fund us further if we are effective. Which they have been asking more and more of us recently. When it comes to trade unions, we don't regularly speak to them. I think that is something we do need to change. I think there's probably a fair few at UHI, just with the different levels of lecturers, but on a regular basis, it isn't something that we do.
Thank you. John's online wants to come in as well. Thanks.
Yeah, I agree with what Heather said as well. The EIS and trade unions, we don't have any relationship with, and I do agree that we have to have that relationship going forward, rather than just meeting us or speaking to us at the times where strikes and so on are happening. In relation to challenging management because of funding, it's not an experience that definitely not something that I would portray onto the SAF. We do have a challenge. We will challenge the management whether they give us funding or not, because again, we work on what we've achieved and what we're achieving going forward and the development going forward. So whether we're funded by them or not, the right thing to do is to challenge them if we have to. And it's just in my experience, that's never been the case.
Ross?
The lack of engagement so far with unions, and it seems like there's an appetite for more of that. Has the barrier to that so far been one of capacity, that there's just so many demands on your time as student association officers? Or is it just the case that neither side has quite reached out to the other to make that a more structured and ongoing relationship yet, and it maybe could be going forward? Because if it's the latter, seems like an easy enough one to solve, but if the biggest barrier to you engaging with staff unions is a lack of capacity on one side or another, there's a bigger structural issue that we need to unpack there before we could fix that.
Heather, you're nodding away. Over to you.
I think for us it's probably an element of both. As a regional officer at HISA, I'm swamped. I sit on so many meetings and so many committees. I've got people pulling for my attention constantly every day. But I also think we haven't reached out to them, but they haven't reached out to us as well. So I do think at some point we probably should do that, and we should sit down and have a talk. But when the industrial action that happened recently, we did put out a statement saying we understood why they were doing this and if students needed support to get in touch with us. So we were trying to sort of cover both areas in that respect. While we understood why they were striking, we understood the impact it would have on students as well. But yeah, I think there's more work that needs to be done there.
Kirsten?
I think at NESCOL it's exactly the same as at HISA. We have the... it's both. But also, I think, in terms of engaging with certain members of staff, whether it be at the college or union reps, there is an element of some members of staff and some union reps still don't value students' associations. They don't value what we have to say. They don't really care. And I think it can be really difficult sometimes to have that discussion. I think going back to that meeting that we had, NUS and EIS FILA, it was like a us versus you, and we don't really care what you have to say because we're going on strike anyway, sort of thing. So I think we kind of, it goes back to another culture problem. We have to have that culture of we're partners, not hierarchy.
Thank you.
One question. It's a specific one for John, unless anybody else is looking to come in and I've just missed them on this.
Lovely. No one else is looking to come in, so you're fine, Ross.
Grand, yes. Thanks. John, if you don't mind, I've just got one question for yourself about your relationship with the regional board, because I was really interested in what Heather was saying about quite a positive relationship there, but also that the variation between your relationship, Heather, with the regional board and individual colleges. I think it's fair to say from some of what we've heard previously that in Glasgow the relationship with the regional board is a bit more, not challenging, but some folk would question what additional value that board is providing on top of the existing relationship between college management and staff union, student associations, etc. John, from the Lanarkshire perspective, is there an added value that you're seeing from having that additional level of regional infrastructure there? What's your relationship with the regional board like? Do you feel you're getting something out of that? Or are you just dealing primarily with management and board level at your individual institution?
My experience in that is that our presidents probably have more experience in the regional board than anything else. I know that our president sits on the regional board and that our outcomes are exactly the same as what we would do to present to our normal board. But I probably don't see any difference between the regional board and our normal board. It's the same work. It's the only thing I do see different is that we only have one member from New College Lanarkshire that sit on that regional board and one that sits from another college within that region. So it would be better if we had two presidents that sat from Lanarkshire on that board, but I can't have an opinion on something I don't see any difference.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, Commissioner.
Thank you very much, Ross. I suppose it's been really tremendous to hear the evidence from yourselves, the people that are really on the ground and going through the education system right at this very moment. So, and you don't often get the opportunity to come to Parliament to make positions and make sure your voices are heard. So I'm giving you the opportunity here, as we've got a little bit of time on our agenda. Is there something that you wanted to desperately say today that perhaps you've not had the opportunity to bring to the committee? And that's a bit of an open floor question there. So does anyone want to go first on that? Kirsten.
I'm sure that you're aware of NUS talking about summer payments for students. I think it's quite a scary time to be a student over the summer. You have to go and get a full-time job. Who's going to give you a full-time job for 2 months and then you're going to go away in August? When are we going to see summer payments for students?
Thank you, Kirsten. That's one for Philip. Heather, you're nodding away. Is there anything else you might want to make us aware of?
Just in complete agreement with Kirsten, to be honest. Having been that student who had a part-time job and had to get a second part-time job over summer and worked myself ragged, it is a very stressful time. And I think summer payments is something that's been spoken about for longer than they've really had some action around. So at this point, I do think they are quite necessary.
Anyone else wanting? Looking online? Amy, just now you've come in. There we go.
Thank you. My query would be around that sort of bottom line. There seems to be no bottom line for students' association funding. I know that our one is the lowest at just, it works out at 23 pence per head for our students, you know, and we try to run as many things as possible, breakfast clubs, things like that, and you know, that's barely one pot of porridge per student for the whole year, and I would love to see some sort of bottom line or baseline where, you know, there's a calculation behind where the funding comes from and the amount that each college gets, so that it is consistent. Whether you're studying in Dundee and Angus, or you're in Aberdeen, or you're in Glasgow, you've still got that level of support from your students' association to be able to offer all these more wraparound services and formal things that really, as I said before, make up your college experience.
Thank you, Amy. And I just want to you've done really well, given that you've not been feeling 100% today in all your contributions. So thank you very much. Kirsten's got her hand up again, so I will go to Kirsten.
It's just to add on Amy's point, baseline staffing would be good as well. I've visited a number of college and university students' associations. And, for example, Aberdeen University Students' Association have more staff in their HR department than we have in the entire NESCOL Students' Association. We have one member of staff who works half and half. Half of her job is to manage the Students' Association and half is engagement generally. And we have one member of staff who's funded by an SFC grant. So really, we don't have a full-time member of staff. How can we support people who are only there for a year? How can we maintain the Students' Association with just that kind of half our staff member who's also half the college? It would be good to see a baseline number of staff members too.
Thank you. And Nicole?
I guess the importance is looking at individual colleges, because although we're all part of the sector, we're all completely different. We're all funded in different ways. We all have different staffing. We all have different students. So, for example, with the funding, if our college student association doesn't have it, we go to our principal and we deliver a case. And, for example, when we're talking about the free breakfast and lunch, you know, that doesn't come directly from the student association. That's directly from the college. I guess people just need to look at individual colleges and how they're so sources of funding are completed and the negotiations individually between them.
Thank you. And over, Alex.
Again, pretty much what everybody else is saying. It's all, for myself, it's all about funding. People like myself, so essentially for half the month, I'm a single man. And the funding for a single man who wants to go back into education is almost non-existent. It's not there. There's no help for us. It's all geared around students who are just leaving home or they're just coming out of high school. But what about people like myself who, after 40-odd years, I need to retrain because of my physical and mental well health? So I have to retrain, but I can't afford to retrain. And for myself, I'm not too sure whether I'm going to be able to financially be able to afford the next 4 years or whether I'm going to have to bite the bullet and go back to work. So funding for people in my group would be amazing.
Thank you, Alex. And John, online, finally. Last one.
Yeah, just a quick comment, convener, just to say that I think my experience over the 10 years is just making sure that, I mean, the work that student associations, the effective work that student associations have carried out over the years, going forward, we need to be funded. And we need to be at the front of that that funding for the officers to make that impact on the ground and for us to be able to support them as a student association going forward and the local students within these colleges, that we need to be adequately funded and make sure that's always at the top tier going forward. That would be my wish anyway.
Thank you very much, and thank you for a great, super informative session this morning, and I'd like to thank you all for your time. We're now going to have a short suspension to allow the witnesses to leave and get set up for the next section. Thank you. session now. Thank you. Agenda item two. Our next item of business is the consideration of two pieces of negative subordinate legislation. The St Mary Music School Aided Places Scotland Amendment Regulation 2022, SSI 2022/172, and the Education Scotland Act 1980 Modification Regulations 2022, SSI 2022/173. So we'll start with the St Mary Music School Aided Places Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. Do any members have any comments on this instrument? I'm looking for... No, that's great. So is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Agreed. Thank you very much. Next is the consideration of the Education Scotland Act 1980 Modification Regulations 2022. And again, do any members have any comments on this instrument? Okay, thank you. So is the committee then agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Agreed. Thank you. That is the public part of today's meeting now at an end, and we will consider our final agenda items in private. And can I ask members attending virtually to reconvene on Microsoft Teams in a few minutes? Thank you very much. Thank you, and good morning.